So good evening, everyone. On behalf of TaskMent, I would like to welcome you all to Medcast Insights into Healthcare, a learning initiative by TaskMent. Today, it's a great pleasure to have with us Dr. R.R. Mantri, who is a consultant, interventional cardiologist and electrophysiologist at Sir Gangaram Hospital, Delhi. Welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, we look forward to hear from you on today's topic of discussion, Mexaletine, an unexplored antiarrhythmic drug. Over to you, Dr. Mantri.
Thank you. So, I am getting the message, host disabled participant screen sharing. What should I do?
Give me a second, sir.
Please enable me.
Done, sir. Try it.
So, I will say it's not unexplored, but I will say rather it is underused drug. And the reason being its non-availability so far in India. I remember to use it way back in 1994 in a patient with acute MI and incessant VT. And that time I got injection Mexitive. I could arrange injection Mexitive through ampoule somehow from somewhere, and I could use So this is rather underused and both under unexplored antiarrhythmic drug. And beauty of this drug is that unlike many antiarrhythmic drug, it does not prolong QT interval. So that is very good part of this drug. And second good part of this drug, I will say, is that it can be used with other antiarrhythmic drugs in a select group or a specific indication where we want to use two antiarrhythmic drugs, one may be ineffective. Like I will give an example, there have been patients, there have been studies involving small number of patients who were on AICD and receiving repeated shock despite treatment of cordoron or having recurrent episode of VTVM despite cordoron. And when cordoron or mexitil was combined, the arrhythmic event dropped dramatically. So this is as an add-on drug to other antiarrhythmic drug also. So I move to the, just a minute. So prevalence of ventricular arrhythmia is increasing both globally and in India because of increasing number of patients surviving post acute MI or post-coronary artery disease because of advent of modern day intervention as well as advancement in medical and device therapy. So globally as well as in our country, we will see more and more patients who are coming with serious clinically important or life-threatening arrhythmias. In United States, estimated rate of approximate 300,000 deaths per year are due to VTVM. We don't have exact number in our country, but a PANA RM heart failure registry was conducted way back about 10 years ago. And in this patient who had who were with heart failure, they were studied for VTVF, and it was found that 4.5% of patients have VTVF who are suffering from heart failure. So therapeutic strategy for management of ventricular tachycardia, we all know, are manifold. The primary treatment remains antiarrhythmic drugs, which are first line management for VT or VT strong. They are inexpensive, they have a rapid effect, especially if available in IV form, and they decrease frequency of arrhythmia and subsequent ICD shocks. There are certain disadvantages associated with antiarrhythmic drugs, that there are contraindications to many of them. There are side effects with each antiarrhythmic drugs, and the therapy usually is lifelong because the underlying condition may be lifelong. ICD is well established especially in ischemic cardiomyopathy with LVEF less than 30% for primary prevention, and for secondary prevention, of course, it is a must. Similarly, for non-ischemic cardiomyopathy also, the common consensus is that it should, these devices should be used in EF less than 35%, but definitely if they are being used for secondary prevention. Catheter ablation, a very important advance is after availability of 3D mapping has been made in this field. And now in most patient catheter ablation is successful in reducing VT storm, reducing frequency of ICD shock, and in some cases, especially with structurally normal heart, there may be permanently curative form of therapy. And sympathetic denervation can be rarely used, and sometimes it may be the only effective therapy, especially if a patient has ischemic VT and a storm. And in that subset, ventilating the patient and doing sympathetic denervation, either surgically or chemically, may be useful. There are case reports where nothing else has been able to stop except this sympathetic denervation. So these are the, this is the classification of antiarrhythmic drugs, we all know. And this is others or class 5, which include adenosine, digoxin, magnesium. So our today's drug belong to sodium channel blocker, and it belong to class 1B. So typically class 1A drugs, they prolong QT interval. Class 1B drugs, they don't change QT interval. And class 1C drug typically shorten QT interval. And these are their dominant indication. But as far as our drug Mexiliten is concerned, its primary use remains in ventricular arrhythmias, not for atrial arrhythmias or WPW, as is the case with other group of drugs. And you all know about class 2, class 3, class 4 drugs. And typically, amiodarone has not only class 3, but class 1 effect also. Similarly, propranolol may also have class 1 effect in addition to beta blocker effect. So this drug basically acts as a sodium channel blocker. That's why blunting the phase 0 of action potential where there is rapid influx of sodium inside the cell. Mexiliten is approved for ventricular arrhythmia use. US FDA has approved it for treatment of ventricular arrhythmia, and of late DCGI has approved it for existing or anticipated ventricular arrhythmia in ectopic beats, such as those found after MI and ischemic heart disease, for arrhythmias induced by drugs, certain drug which produce QT interval prolongation and arrhythmia. And for idiopathic arrhythmias also it can be used. Now ACC HRS guidelines recommend Mexiliten in treatment of ventricular tachycardia. According to 2017 guidelines, Mexiliten is amongst the recommended antiarrhythmic agent to prevent or treat ventricular arrhythmias or ventricular fibrillation. And similarly, Heart Rhythm Society 2014 guidelines says that Mexiliten is amongst the recommended antiarrhythmic drug in patients suffering from symptomatic non-sustained ventricular arrhythmia or an adequately dosed beta blocker or a non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker antagonist so as to improve symptoms associated with arrhythmia episode. And it is amongst the recommended drug in patients with structural heart disease and recurrent symptomatic ventricular tachycardia in and above ICD and ablation. And this is class 2A deletion. So Mexiliten is, we know that class 1B antiarrhythmic agent. It is a sodium channel blocker. It is important to note here that Mexiliten has also been used for spasmodic pain relief also. It has structurally similar to lidocaine, but orally active. So we can call it oral lidocaine also. It inhibits the advanced sodium current, reducing phase zero of the action potential. Site of action is Purkinje fibers. And though effective refractive period is decreased, and action potential duration is also decreased, there is more reduction in action potential duration. So ERP-APD ratio is slightly increased. And so it's an orally active class 1B antiarrhythmic drug, which blocks the fast sodium channel and opens potassium channel, thus reduces the rate of depolarization of the cardiac action potential. And it reduces ventricular otomasticity while shortening both action potential duration and effective refractive period. It is an oral congener of lidocaine, as we have already discussed. These are the electrophysiological properties which are similar to lidocaine. That is, patient with normal conduction system, there is minimal effect on cardiac impulse generation and propagation. And this adds, this feature is specifically useful in patients who otherwise have sinus node disease or AV node disease. So there is no development of second degree or third degree AV block, no prolongation of ventricular depolarization or repolarization. So that again is an advantage. So, and patient with pre-existing conduction defect, it does not cause depression of sinus rate, it does not prolong sinus node recovery time, decrease conduction velocities, increase improve. So these are the properties of this drug. So minimal effect on electrophysiology, unlike other antiarrhythmic drugs. So here, if you see, all other drugs have either predominantly increase or decreasing effect or neutral effect. But if you look at maxiliten, there is no effect of SA node. There is no effect on AV node refractive period. PR interval does not change. QRS duration does not change. QT interval does not change. So similar, and also it does not affect ejection fraction or function of the heart. So it can be used in patient with depressed LV function as well. So there is no significant effect on hemodynamics. So many drugs we can't give when patient is hemodynamically compromised, but these drugs can be given safely. And small, usually no statistically significant decrease in cardiac output, no significant negative inotropic effect. Blood pressure and pulse rate remain essentially unchanged. There is mild depletion of myocardial function similar to that produced by lidocaine, and has occasionally with IV therapy in patient with cardiac. So except for IV therapy, there is no effect on cardiac function with oral medicine. It is very well absorbed drug. More than 90% from GI tract, peak blood level are reached within 2 to 3 hours. 50 to 60% of it is plasma protein bound. And it's unlike lidocaine, its first fast metabolism is low, and its metabolite is electrically neutral. It does not have any antiarrhythmic property. And only 10% is excreted by kidneys, 90% is by liver. So it can be safely used in patients with advanced kidney disease also. Dosage must be individualized on the basis of response and tolerance, both of which are dose related. Administration with food or antacid is recommended. GI side effect remains the most common side effect. So administer it with food or antacid. Initiate with 200 milligram every 8 hours when rapid control of arrhythmia is not essential, and minimum of 2 to 3 days between the dose adjustment recommended. Dose may be adjusted to 50 to 100 milligram increment up or down. And when rapid control of tachyarrhythmia is essential, loading dose is 400 milligram. and after each 8 hours at 200 milligrams. Continue as per chronic treatment. When rapid control of arrhythmia is not essential, 200 milligrams every 8 hours, then it can be increased to 300 milligrams or 400 milligrams every 8 hours, depending on clinical response. Contraindications are cardiogenic shock. Of course, we have to stabilize hemodynamics and advanced degree of AV block if no pacemaker is present. Though, as we have discussed, it does not induce AV node PR interval prolongation, but if there is pre-existing at high degree AV block, then in absence of pacemaker, it should not be given. And adverse effect usually are very mild. It is a very well-tolerated drug. There are reversible gastrointestinal and nervous system adverse reactions. So most common of them is upper GI distress, lightheadedness, tremors, coordination difficulty. So these tremors and coordination difficulty are seen at higher doses, typically 400 milligram per day. And they are like side effect which we see with lidocaine. Very few clinical data exist. In fact, there is no head-to-head randomized controlled trial vis-a-vis other drugs. There are small trials which are on small number of patients. Most of the trials has number less than 100. But however, whatever little data we have, we will discuss. So maxiritin, in this trial, maxiritin significantly reduces recurrent VTVF episode, electrical storm event, and ICD intervention in 13 patients where it was 600 milligram per day and given for 8 months, and in 4 patients it was 400 milligram three times daily, 400 milligram daily, and in 13 patients 600 milligram daily. So this study is of total 17 patients. And as you can see, ICD intervention was significantly reduced. VTVF episode again highly significantly reduced, and electrical storm again highly significantly reduced. So this study is of 2017, but consisting of only 17 patients. And maxiritin is controlled in controlled comparative trials, significant reduction of ventricular premature beat, paired beats, episodes of non-sustained VT versus placebo, similar in effectiveness to the active agent. An active agent which has been compared is Advin, various drugs like cardiolan, sotalol, etc. Follow-up of patient from controlled trial demonstrated continuous effectiveness in long-term. And the competitive agent have been disopyramide, procainamide, quinidine. It reduces ventricular ectopic complexes in patients with recent MI. This is data from another trial where 344 patients at high risk after sustained myocardial infarction and preceding 1 to 2 weeks. And it was administered as loading dose of 400 milligrams followed by 250 milligram 8 hourly for 3 months. This trial goes way back to 1980. And what we have seen is that before entry, there was no significant difference in these arrhythmias. After 1 month, there was significant difference. At 3 months, the difference is maintained. And maxiritin as an adjuvant therapy with other antiarrhythmic drugs, so and other antiarrhythmic devices. So treatment with antiarrhythmic drugs in ICD patient. So antiarrhythmic therapy is recommended for suppression of VTVF or suppression of SVT. These may lead to ICD shocks, which may be appropriate or inappropriate, and thus they interfere with quality of life. And also, there are drugs which may increase tachycardia cycle length. So the VT may become hemodynamically better tolerated. Patient may have time to reach hospital, or It may be terminated by ATP character of the device, and thus there is better response to anti-tachycardia pacing. So basically, to reduce the VTVF events and to prolong its cycle length so that it can be reverted to normal sinus rhythm without giving shock, that is just by anti-tachycardia pacing. So methylate, in this study shows that methylatin reduces VTVF events and appropriate therapies in patients with ICD. So VTVF episode before methylatin, number this, on methylatin, number this, 3 months, 3 months on methylatin. So again, we can see that though the number of episodes and number of patients were small, only 29 patients, but again, we can see that there was significant reduction in appropriate shocks, appropriate ATP therapy, and even one reduction of shock is important for the patient. And methylatin as combination therapy to amiodarone and recurrent refractory VT. So this again is a study of 9 patients. Day 1 to 2 methylatin 1000 milligram 24 hours along with IV amiodarone, and then followed by oral amiodarone. From day 3, IV treatment interrupted, methylatin and amiodarone 600 milligram per day, follow up for 6 months. And the study shows that total suppression of VT episode within 3 days was seen in approximately 33 of patients. Total suppression at 7 days was seen in 66% of the patients. So combination is better when single therapy doesn't work. Effect of methylatin on heart rate corrected QT interval. So again, in small number of patients, 12. So there is no significant increase in QT, rather QT interval, in fact, at the best decrease with methylatin, it did not increase. And this figure shows the effect of methylatin on arrhythmic event in patient with long QT syndrome. So this drug can be given in long QT syndrome. The patient with arrhythmic event before start of therapy, 22. After that, it was 3, significant reduction. And mean number of arrhythmic event per patient also reduced dramatically after treatment with methylatin. So methylatin is effective in shortening QTC in patient with long QT2. So this is specifically recommended in patient with long QT2 syndrome, but it can be used in other QT syndromes also, especially useful in long QT2. It may provide an additional therapeutic strategy when combined with beta blocker in patient at high risk. So to summarize, it is indicated in sustained ventricular arrhythmia. And I'm happy to say that till now we had amiodarone as the only effective drug in majority of patients, which has a lot of side effect in many patients. And with the advent of this availability of this drug, now we can use this drug more and more, especially in patients with ventricular arrhythmia. It is agent with moderate potency. It is agent with appreciable safety. It is safe in LV dysfunction, safe in QT prolongation. Amiodarone is not safe in QT prolongation because amiodarone itself causes QT prolongation. And if it is patient has underlying QT prolongation, amiodarone may in fact increase arrhythmia rather than controlling or decreasing them. And the side effects are reversal and non-lethal. It has class 2 recommendation by the guidelines for management of VT. And it can be used as on drug to amiodarone, sotalol, beta blockers, and in patient with ICD. Thank you for your patience listening.
Very well elaborated, sir. So I'll request the participants, if they're having any query, they can put the questions in the Q&A box.
I don't think there should be any query. This is a new drug and everybody must be tired by now. But if there is some query and if I will be able to answer, I will certainly answer. But I am using this drug. Recently, I used this drug in a girl with QT prolongation with recurrent episode of VT. And I got very good clinical result. And I have confirmed it by Walter that she was having repeated episode of torsad. And after starting this, she is doing clinically very well. So if there are no questions, I think we say good.
Conclude the session, sir.
Yes, we conclude.
Yeah. We are having one question from Dr. B.S. Vivek, if you could answer, sir. Can we switch over from Cordiron to this drug, given the numerous side effects?
That's a very intelligent question. See, we know that Cordiron is definitely, if we compare efficacy, Cordiron is definitely much more efficacious and rapidly acting than Maxiliten. But if there are numerous side effects, I think as you can see, it is a class 2 indication. We can shift from Cordiron to this drug. Or we can reduce the doses of Cordiron. I will choose the middle path. I will reduce the dose of Cordiron and add this drug along with Cordiron to achieve better efficacy. Because as we know, this drug is moderately effective. Now, if I want much better effect and less side effect, I would like to reduce the dose of Cordiron and add on this drug. As has been done in many smaller studies as I have enumerated. Okay.
So we can conclude, sir.
Yes, sure.
Thank you, Dr. Mantri, for joining with us today. It was really an insightful discussion for us as well as for our listeners. I would also like to thank all the doctors for being with us and for the active participation during the session. Thank you and have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you, sir. Good night, sir.
Good night.